Hi everyone, my name is Manikanta. I'm a Java backend developer. I'm planning to create a set of videos which covers end-to-end Kubernetes topics. And these videos are very helpful for application developer as well as Kubernetes admins. Here I have specified required topics. Once you cover all these topics with enough practice, you will be having a good knowledge on Kubernetes. Now let us jump into our actual topic, Kubernetes, and what is the real use case of Kubernetes, and what's the origin of Kubernetes. Then after, we'll discuss more about virtual machine versus container, virtualization, hypervisor, containerization, and some pros and cons. Now, so what is a Kubernetes? It's a software which is implemented by Google. Now it's maintaining by Cloud Native Computing Foundation. So Kubernetes, it's an orchestrator and it deploys the container-based application on cloud. So if we think about the real use case of Kubernetes, if you think about a big organization like Google, Amazon, Netflix, they are maintaining thousands of microservices to accept your orders or to confirm your bookings. Whatever the reason behind implementing these microservices, and behind the screens, these microservices talk to each other, and maintaining these microservices and deploying these microservices, apart from the functional things, if you want to achieve the non-functional things like 24/7, it has to be available and it has to use optimal system resource and deploying automatically. Is it really possible to a human and manually? It's a nightmare, but it is a very easy task to Kubernetes. What really Kubernetes does? Kubernetes deploys container-based application on cloud by accepting the AML input. That AML input contains deployment criteria, and the Kubernetes makes sure the desired state of an application. So before we deep dive into what is a deployment criteria, what is the container-based application, how the Kubernetes deploys it on a cloud, so we need to understand about the containerization process and what is the container, because container and Kubernetes are highly related. So container is nothing but a packet. It contains your code and required binaries and libraries. And the process of preparing a container is called containerization. And it's very agile and very lightweight. So how the containerization concept came into the picture? So in early days, we used to deploy our monolithic application or microservices in virtual machines. So we need to talk about virtual machines and containerization, virtualization, and we need to discuss about pros and cons. So once you have this knowledge, you can easily map the Kubernetes topic and you can easily visualize how Kubernetes works behind the screens. Now let us talk about virtual machine. Virtual machine is an imitation of your physical computer for achieving virtualized computing environment. It enables multiple operating systems on a single computer. Now the question is how VMs can access your hardware. So by using virtualization process. So virtualization process where a tiny software plays a key role which runs on top of your computer, and it works like a bridge between your guest operating system and physical hardware. If you imagine a virtual machine running on your PC, and it runs with some set of restrictions with the limited system resources only. Let's take a look into the diagram which I have created. So here the hypervisor is in between your guest operating system and physical hardware. This is the type 1 hypervisor. And if you purchase a Windows 10, and Windows 10 built-in having a type 1 hypervisor, and the type 1 hypervisor runs directly on your hardware. So spinning or installing the virtual machines on Windows 10, it is no latency. But if you take a look into the type 2 hypervisor, it runs on your host operating system, which means any system resource request which is coming from guest operating system, that is nothing but virtual machines. Now hypervisor is taking responsibility of fulfilling its job through a host operating system. it allows some latency. The main goal of type 1 or type 2 are same, virtualization process. So if you want to deploy any of your application that can be a monolithic or microservice, to deploy on your virtual box, you need a separate operating system, kernel, and file system. So a dedicated virtualized hardware needs to be assigned to a guest operating system through hypervisor. Now let's talk about the container. Containers are very lightweight compared with the VMs. The reason behind it, containers contain only your code and binaries and libraries, where VMs contains operating system, file system, and kernels. So it requires more system space than container. And container is a kind of operating system level virtualization, where to access the system resource, containers uses the same user space and same CPU, same RAM. Just container manager will taking care of the restrictions and permissions by using namespace and C groups. So when we discuss more about the container engine, that is the Docker engine, we'll discuss more about the C groups and namespaces. But if you take a comparison study between virtual machine and container, containers are more lightweight. To access any system resource, container communicate with container manager called engines, where to access a hardware belongs to a physical computer, VM used to talk with the hypervisor. So it's the communication between the VM and the hypervisor and the communication between the container manager and the container are pretty much same. But here, hypervisor provides a dedicated hardware for your VM, but container manager, container engine will talk to host operating system to serve the purpose of a specific running instance of a container. So that is the reason container is a operating system level isolation. So now, if you take a look into the diagram which I have created, the virtual machine, if you imagine your application you have deployed on your VM, it requires a separate operating system and kernel and file system. If you deploy your application as a container, you need not to install any separate operating system. So container engine will take care of communicating with the operating system. So container engine will take care of isolation, and container engine will take care of communicating with the required hardware by using the C groups and namespaces. So that's the reason containers are very lightweight and agile. So now let us talk about some of the important points, and then we can, for your use case, you can pick up either a virtual machine or a container. So if you take a point isolation and security point of view, virtual machine is more secure than container by default, but the same security you can achieve in the container as well by using a different isolation level at container engine. And when it comes to operating system maintenance and virtual machine, you need to install operating system on each and every virtual machine, but container, you need not install any operating system. So at this point, container is preferable. And if it comes to the deployment is much easier if you are go with a container concept. And in the deploying a virtual machine, you need to go with a hypervisor manager. And OS upgrades and security patches, it's moreover, it's the same, but is more comfortable with the container, because in the container concept, you need to pick up a base image, where the virtual machine, you need to reinstall, sometimes you need to restart the VM instance itself. And it's the time consuming and it occupies the most space. And the container side, you need to pick the right base version which got resolved by the security patches, and it might be the latest base image. And persistent storage is pretty much same. It uses its local storage and the containers uses its local storage. And when it comes to the shared file, you can go with the NFS, and here as well, you can go with the NFS or SMBs. So load balancing concept is a bit difficult in the virtual machine side, but the load balancing is much easier in the containerization concept, because load balancer will be taken care by Kubernetes, where the Kubernetes doesn't move your container from one place to another place. Instead of that, Kubernetes, what it does, it stops the container at one node and it brings up your container in another node, where the VM, the entire VM will move from one node to another node. That is a costly operation when compared with the switching of the containers on Kubernetes environment. And the fault tolerance, it's easy if you go with the Kubernetes deployment using the containerized-based application. And again, maintenance and cost. If you think about the maintenance and cost, containers are pay as you use. It's a variable length consumption, where VMs are vertically scaling. It's difficult to achieve the horizontal scaling, but still we can achieve the horizontal scaling using the VM instances. But still, it requires a separate operating system, file system, and kernels. It consumes more system space and disk and RAM and CPU. That's the reason it's a costly solution when compared with the containerization solution. So there are still many reasons to use the VMs. VMs are not bad, but if you compare with the VMs and containers, containers are a reason to choose. There are many reasons to choose. So, and containers are very much easy to achieve the CI/CD. It's like in the continuous implementation and continuous deployment concept. When you implement some component in the agile model, you need to deploy your component in every 2 weeks or every month. So in such a case, it is better to go with container concept. You need not spend much time on deployment. And even your team doesn't require to think about the environmental setup and everything. Everything will be taken care of by Kubernetes itself. So this is the overall discussion about the virtual machine and containers. And if you really like this video,